no. Oh no, you never let go. Through the calm and through the storm. Oh no, you never let go. In every high and every low. Oh no, you never let go. Lord, you never let go of me. Oh no, you never let go of me. Oh no, you never let go of me. Oh no, you never let go of me. Yay! Thank you, Jesus.
Amen.
God, for this beautiful day. Thank you for all our neighbors. Thank you for all that you do. We love you, Lord.
I sing a simple song of love to my Savior, to my Jesus. I'm grateful for the things you've done, my loving Savior. Oh, precious Jesus, my heart is glad that you've called me your own. There's no place I'd rather be than in your arms, love. In your arms, love. Holding me still, holding me near. In your arms, love.
The best place to be, Janet.
Amen, sister.
I sing a simple song of love to my Savior, to my Jesus. I'm grateful for the things you've done, my loving Savior. Oh, precious Jesus. Glad that you've called me your own. Well, there's no place I'd rather be. My heart is glad. My heart is glad that you've called me your own. Well, there's no place I'd rather be than in your arms of love. In your arms of love.
Hello.
Holding me near. Holding me still. Holding me near. Holding me still. Holding me near. In your arms of love. In your arms.
What are you doing?
Oh, my
goodness.
Oh, we'll pray for you.
You're doing great.
September 19th.
Oh, yeah, good day. It's
awesome.
A good, good day.
Oh, what's his name?
Grayson.
Grayson, oh.
Hey, Grayson.
Wow.
We're not going to go.
You are a cutie pie. Look at those blue eyes.
Yeah.
My goodness.
I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus? Oh, in all of you be still. Will I stand in your presence? Or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine. I can only imagine. comes when I find myself standing in the sun. I can only imagine when all I would do is forever worship you. I can only imagine. Jesus, oh, when all of you be still, will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall, will I sing hallelujah, will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine, I can only imagine, I can only imagine. I can only imagine. I can only imagine. I can only imagine. I can only imagine.
Thank you for this day. And welcome all the neighbors that want to come to praise with you. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the sunshine. We pray for all of us.
I can only imagine.
Such a beautiful song.
So thankful that you're here with us, Father, that no matter what storms that we go through, even when we're not faithful, you are faithful, God. How thankful we are, God, that you're always there.
In your presence, Lord, I am on my knees, waiting for your gentle touch. That means so much to me. In your presence, Lord, I reach out to you, and I know you're there. See me through. Hold me close to you, Lord. Never let me go. Oh, Jesus, I love you with all my heart and soul. I love you.
wine for you?
Absolutely not. Everyone is welcome.
It's the beauty of an outdoor church.
All of God's creation.
Yes.
Oh Lord, it is your great name that has power to change lives, Lord. All we have to do is call on your name, Jesus. The lost are saved, find a way at the sound of your
you're doing in our lives right now, Father. We just pray that you continue to do a mighty work in us, to do a mighty work through us, Father God in heaven. We just thank you.
Jesus, when you came down here to love on us,
here with the purpose in your heart. You came to die for our sins, the debt that we could not pay. We are forever grateful, God. Thank you for sending your Son.
The nails in your hands, the nail in your feet, they tell me how much you love me. The thorns on your brow, they tell me how you bore so much shame to love me. When the heavens pass away and all your scars will still remain, and forever they will say just how much you love me. So I want to say forever my love,
forever being with us, forever being in our hearts, in our minds, and just in our lives, Father. If we need you more, we need you now, Father, in this time. Lord God in heaven, there's so many things going on in our crazy country, Father God in heaven. We just ask that you would continue to have grace and mercy upon us. Lord God in heaven, we continue to pray and then just come to you, Father, with our petitions, that you, Father God in heaven, would be seen throughout the globe, Lord God in heaven, that your presence would be felt and known. So these things, Father God in heaven, we just thank you. And we just want to praise you and just give you all glory for all that you do in our life. Whatever you say. Huh?
Where is the land that was named? mercy seat. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you.
Amazing Grace. Please sing if you know. And I'm sorry I don't have the words, but you might know.
Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did the grace appear the hour I first believed.
My chains are gone. I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. And like the flood, His mercy reigns. Unending love, amazing grace. I remember the day that I was saved, and that was amazing. The Lord has promised good to me. His word, my hope secures. He will my shield and portion. As life endures, my chains are gone. I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy reigns. Amazing grace. Chains are gone. I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy reigns. Like snow, the sun forbear to shine. But God, who called me here below, will be forever mine. Will be forever mine. You are forever mine. This is a beautiful song about much Jesus loves us. I don't know if many people know how far He would go, what mountains He would move just to say, I love you.
Hey,
Jesus.
He is jealous of me. Loves like a hurricane. I am a tree bending beneath the weight of His wind and mercy. When all of a sudden I am unaware of these afflictions eclipsed by glory, and realize just how beautiful You are, and how great Your affections are for me. And oh, how He loves us so. Oh, how He loves us. How He loves us all. He's jealous of me. He loves like a hurricane, and I am a this wind and mercy. When all of a sudden I am unaware of these afflictions eclipsed by glory, and realize just how beautiful you are and how great your affections are for me. Grace in his eyes. If grace is an ocean, well, we're all sinking. So heaven meets earth like an unforeseen kiss, and my heart turns violently inside of my chest. I don't have time to maintain these regrets when I think about the way he loves us. Oh, how he loves us. Oh,
loved us enough to send his only begotten son. I can't even imagine losing my son, let alone giving him away to die for someone or people that didn't even know me or love me or care about me or spit in my face. But he did it. And he did it for everyone. No matter what you've done, it doesn't matter. He died for every sin you committed. And he says, I love you. No matter what you've done, I forgive you. My son died for you so that we could be together forever. That love, that never-ending love, can be yours today. If you've never known how much he loves you, did you know you only have to ask? And if you mean it with all your heart, he knows. He knows all things. And he goes wherever you go. Well, even when you say, not now, Lord, maybe when I'm done with all of this stuff here, he'll say, because he's a gentleman, I wait. Because I love you, I will wait.
He loves you. Oh, how he loves you. Oh, how he loves you. Oh, how he loves you.
Amen, Lord. Jesus, three in one, God's Spirit, the Holy Son, Holy Spirit.
Brothers and sisters in other countries that are being killed, persecuted, Father. Rain down on them, Lord. Rescue them. You are our Redeemer. You are our Rescuer, Lord. Father, tonight, we want to lay down our burdens. We want to lay down all the things that are heavy in our hearts, the things that we keep picking up. We need to let it down and let you have it, Lord. Because you know the best way. Give us faith, God. Give us that mustard seed that moves the mountains. We're asking for a transformation, Lord, from this day forward. That, Father, we live the way that you had planned us to live from the very beginning of time. You knew us before we were in our mother's womb. You have a plan for every person here, and every person here was meant to be here because you called them, Lord, and you have a special message for them. And I just pray over all of them, Lord. Pray over Pastor Ron, that only your words would speak through him, and that they would hear you and receive the gift of whatever it is that they're going on in their lives, Lord. Only you know. And we're so thankful, God, that we don't have to pick up our burdens, that we can pray and request anything before you. You said if we ask with all our heart, soul, and mind, if we search you with all our heart, soul, and mind, we will find you. Lord, we want to be there. Yes, Lord, we thank you.
Boy, what a wonderful, wonderful night, huh? To have an outdoor service. It's been so long since I've been able to preach and see faces. Usually I'm staring into that camera right over there, which is really hard, you know, because I'm someone who likes to get excited, I say, or, you know, feed off the Holy Spirit and the energy. So I'm not a Pentecostal, but I'd surely love to have the Holy Spirit filling me when we're preaching. So we're very subdued on Tuesday nights sometimes. Speaking of Tuesday nights, we're doing a Revelation study. We're in chapter 18 now, so if anybody wants to join us on that, I'll give you a link or something and you guys can tap in. You know, we want to do more of this, though. You know, I feel like where we're at in today's environment, you know, with the coronavirus, with everything that's going on, you know, I think our country really does need a coming together, you know, through the Holy Spirit, through the Lord Jesus Christ. If we just would, you know, be obedient to him and give our lives to him, a lot of the problems that we suffer today would not exist, right? The backbiting, the fighting, you know, everything that's going on, you know, in our country today. We can look at it and we can say, where is God? Where is God in all of this, right? And we know he's in control. That's a beautiful thing about it. At least most of us who love the Lord Jesus Christ and believe in him know that he is in control. Others believe that they are in control, that they have the power, that they want to be able to control the outcome of what we see. And we don't want to do that. We want to be part of God's kingdom. We want to be able to come together, and we want to be able to just worship him. We want to read his word. Oops, sorry. We want to be able to, excuse me, bend over and pick up my my darn, I'm making more noise putting the wind screen up. I should just leave it off, right? Okay, we're done with that because I suspect it will come off again. Anyways, so tonight I just want to give a brief message, you know, and a reminder of, you know, what God expects from us, you know, to exhort, to evangelize, to encourage, to stand in the gap together. Those are the things that we want to do as a body. And the only way we can do that is if we all come together and understand that the Lord is our King. The Lord is going to guide us. And if we follow those principles, then we will be able to get through every day. We'll be able to get through the troubles that we're going through. Every one of us right now are experiencing some trouble in our lives, right? You know, we're experiencing things that maybe make us uncomfortable. But through God's grace and God's mercy, he'll be able to take us through them. So I just want to give a, you know, just a brief message. Like I said, if that's possible, Paula will think it's not possible. Lou will say it's not possible either. But we're going to try. So, you know, exhort, evangelize, and encourage. You know, one of the things that we want to do when we accept the Lord Jesus Christ and we sincerely give our lives to him, nothing can separate us from his love. The first thing that we have to understand is that when we're with God, we're with God's love. So let's open up to Romans 8, 35, 37, and we're just going to read some scripture. I'm just going to go through, and we got lots of scripture here. If you don't have it, that's okay. We'll we'll make sure that, you know, we get it together. So Matthew, or Romans, I'm sorry, 8:32. 8:35-37. So let's go. It says here that who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, shall distress, shall or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are killed all day long. We are counted as sheep for the slaughter. Yet in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. So what is Paul telling us in this scripture? That it doesn't matter what comes against us, what tribulations. It doesn't matter what kind of distress we're in, how we're getting persecuted, because we're all getting persecuted right today. You're either on one side getting persecuted or you're on the other side getting persecuted. But for Christians especially, we feel the persecutions. We can see what's happening in, you know, the Christian society, right? Or the Christian church or the Christian life. You know, we can't go to church anymore. We can't amass in the buildings, right? You know, there's a lot, especially in California. Now, not every state is like that, but it just seems like, you know, we're in a state where we can't go to church, which is crazy to me, right? We can go get our alcohol. We can go do all kinds of crazy things. We can go to the movies. We can now. But, you know, we can't go to church. We can't amass. And that is just unbiblical, right? You know, God calls us to gather. He calls us to gather in his name. And so what we need to do is we need to remember that, but we also need to remember when we're in his love that there's nothing that can come against us. Nothing. Nothing, absolutely. As Christians, our hope is given to us by God through his love. The love that he has for us, Romans 5:5 says, now hope does not disappoint because the love of God has poured into our hearts by the Holy Spirit who was given to us. Right, so the Holy Spirit was a gift from God to us, right? When Jesus died on the cross and he ascended into heaven, he left behind the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit to do several things. One of them was to record what the apostles and what the disciples were speaking about. To record it and bring to their memory the things that Jesus had taught them. So these are the things as we evangelize, as we exhort, as we stand together, as we understand what God is trying to do in our lives, that we can put our faith and put all our trust in him, put all our hope in him. And right now, it kind of seems hopeless, right? I mean, you know, for us that are working and stuff, you know, that are still working, it seems like it's okay. You know, there are some inconveniences, but there are many people out there who are struggling. Many people are struggling with addiction. Many people are struggling right now because of this virus with suicide. Many people are suffering with depression, more so than what we've seen in the past. And you know, that is a direct attack from the enemy. Satan wants to come in and he wants to sift everybody's lives. And he wants to sift those who don't have hope. And he will go to and fro. He will, you know, he will scour the earth to find those who are weak, who are hopeless. And what is our job? Our job as Christians, as brothers and sisters in Christ, as believers, our job is to stand next to them, to exhort them, to exalt them, to encourage them. You know, even to evangelize to them. You know, give them scripture. Give them things that they can put their trust in. And the things that they can put their trust in are the Word of God. God. Right? That's where we put our trust. That's where our trust has to lie. Right? If we trust in, you know, our jobs, if we trust in our... We can't even put our trust in our spouses. Right? Because we are human. We will fail. You know, as human beings, we are going to let everybody down. You know, at one time or another in our lives. You know, and sometimes it's a small letdown, sometimes it's a large letdown. But who will never let us down is God. And the hope we have in him, because of the love that he pours into us, is what the difference is. Right? I contend this. If everybody in Congress and Senate had the love of God in them, this country would look much different than what it does today. We started with godly principles in this country. And there's a transformation going on. Paul prayed for a transformation. Unfortunately, we see a transformation that's going on in the country. We're kicking God out because we're losing hope. You know, half the country is kicking God out of society, right? And when you start with your children, it propagates. It's a generational thing, right? You start in the schools. Look when they started kicking God out of the schools in the 60s. Now, what is it? It's 2020. So roughly 60 years it took to start transforming, you know, where we're at in our country. You know, and what we have to remember is that the love of God in us is going to drive us. It's going to take us to the next, or keep us safe, and take us to a place where we're not going to falter very easily. You know, we will fail at times. I mean, we all agree. But there are times where, you know, we stand in God's strength and God's love. And we're not going to fail. You know, God's love has no boundaries. He strengthens us through His love. 1 Thessalonians 3:11 through 13. Let's turn there, please. And it says, "Now many, now may our God and Father Himself and our Lord Jesus Christ direct our way to you. And may the Lord make you increase and abound in love to one another and to all, just as we do to you, so that He may establish your hearts blameless in holiness before our God and Father at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ with all of His saints." Now, these scriptures that I've given to you are scriptures of exhortation, right? They're evidences that when God loves us, actions will take place, right? We will increase in our love for others when God loves us, when we receive that love will continue to increase when we love one another. And, you know, what Paul is talking about here is when the apostles went to the churches, they went because God's love, they were filled with God's love. And they were obedient, and they were faithful. And they went to the churches to minister to the people. Just as we're called to do, right? We're called to minister to others. You know, it doesn't necessarily have to be in a church. It could be in this setting here, right? But we are called to go and to minister. And when we have God's love in us, there's no boundary, there's nothing that can stop us from doing that, except for ourselves, right? You know, there are a lot of times that God is speaking to me and I'm not paying close enough attention. And opportunities will fall by the wayside. Now, as you mature in your Christian walk, you look for those opportunities everywhere we go. Right, Paul? It's true. It's true. You know, there are so many opportunities at the grocery store. You guys realize that? Just at the grocery store. When you go, there's opportunities to minister to everybody there. Home Depot is a great ministry field. You know, there are so many places that we can go. But this is what God is calling us to do now. There are so many pastors with the same message. And this is a message that is getting, God is talking to all of us about. Get His message out. And you know, we have to find ways to do it. Right? Clever ways now, because the enemy is trying to stifle God's message. And it's really true. I mean, you know, John MacArthur, you know, his church. You know, he's boldly going forward and preaching the word, but he's paying penalties because of it. And there are so many churches out there that don't want to pay the penalty, don't want to, you know, don't want to go against what the government tells us. But biblically, we have to stand. We have to stand for what we believe in. What are our principles? Our principles are the Lord Jesus Christ. Our principles are the kingdom of heaven, right? And we have justification biblically to stand against those things, you know, what we're doing here, you know. There is such a fire that has started in our hearts. I believe this, that the revival starts in each and every one of our hearts. We can't have a revival in a building, because a building is an innate object, right? So you can sit in a building, but if you're not on fire for the Lord Jesus Christ, is the revival going to start in that building? The answer is no. You can stand on a street corner. If you're filled and on fire with the Holy Spirit, can a revival start there? The answer is yes. Can we be in a driveway and a revival start here? The answer is yes. So we have to distinguish and make a determination. How do we want to serve God? You know, so often when we started, when Paul and I, when God gave us this ministry, one of the things he told us is we're going to be going out, you know, and we started a ministry that knocked on doors, and we would go door to door, and we would knock, and just, we didn't have Bibles, we didn't have tracts, we had nothing, but the faith that when we knock on a door, someone will answer. And it happened, and we would just ask simply, can we pray for you? And there were so many people that would say yes, but so many more that would say no. And it's astonishing. No, I'm a Christian. I don't need prayer. Now, on the surface, that sounds kind of funny, huh? But when you drill down, it's, you know, people maybe are ashamed for what they're going through, and they don't want to expose it, so they don't want prayer. But there were so many people that would say no, and we would ask if we could go to the end of the driveway and pray for them. And we would be praying in our little circle, and I'd look up, and they'd be at the door listening, because they're interested. And that ministry, don't be surprised, in our neighborhood, if you get a knock on the door. Because that ministry is coming back around. It really changed my life. And it was so amazing, you know, and that's just one way that God, you know, gave us hope and built our faith. And just real quickly, there's a man who learned he had cancer. We used to go out on Saturday mornings. He learned he had cancer on Friday night. He was reading his Bible, looking for scripture, looking for hope. And we were knocking on the door, can we pray for you? And it changed his life. But not only his life, but it changed my life too. And I think it changed your life. When God uses us and takes us to a place that we have no idea where we're going, and then all of a sudden, people start pouring in, and everybody is pouring in, you know, the hurt that they have or the needs that they have, and we can stand up and we can pray and represent the Lord, there's nothing better. You know, that's part of encouraging. That's part of going out and evangelizing, you know, God's Word. You know, come to me in the kingdom of heaven. Revelation 2:7 says, he who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. To him who overcomes, I will give to eat from the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God. So Revelation 2:7, right? Let's go there. I'll read it again, because this is important for us to understand that when we don't believe or we don't trust that the Lord is going to take care of our every need. You know, Jesus, through the seven churches, the seven letters to the seven churches, says, he who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. To him who overcomes, I will give to eat from the tree of life, which is in the midst of the paradise of God. So what's Jesus telling us through John? He's telling us that there is a tree of life in heaven waiting for us if we believe, if we're obedient, if we start doing things that God asks us to do. We will find that tree of life. That's God's promise. And that's scripture that we can share with others who don't believe, share with others who need to believe, right? Who have hope. Are hopeless, right? Without God, there's no.
63.
Oh, okay. I said 7-ish. You're stuck. I'm kidding. Matthew 9:22. But Jesus turned around, and when he saw her, he said, "Be of good cheer, daughter. Your faith has made you well." And the woman was made well from that hour. Now, these scriptures may sound like they're bouncing around, but they're for purpose. These are to give us an understanding that we, you know, when we believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, He will heal us. You know, the ailments we have, God can heal us. But we have to have faith. We all heard faith of a mustard seed, right? You know, I mean, that's the faith that we have to have. When we pray, don't end your prayer with "I hope." End your prayer and "thank you, Lord, for healing me." End your prayer, "thank you, Lord, for providing for me." Not, "I hope that you do that." Right? There's a difference. You know, there's a hope in our Lord Jesus Christ, right? But there's also a firmness when we go to the Lord with faith that says, you know what? I know in faith you're going to heal me. I know in faith you're going to take care of me financially. I know in faith that as I walk and develop my relationship with you, you will build me to the man or woman or child that you made me to be. You know, we will find everlasting life through God's promise, right? Matthew or John 3:15, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. Again, it goes back to Revelation 2:7. When we believe in him, when we love him, when we honor him, when we cherish him, and we turn our life towards him, he's going to give us that life. And there's nothing that we can do, because we read scripture that says nothing can come against us and God and the love that he has for us. Nothing can break that love that he has for us. We can reject him all day long, and eventually he'll deal with us, right? He has a way to bring us to that place. You know, do we think in our nation right now we're at that place? Do you think that we need to repent? Do you think we need revival? We sure do. There's so many things that we need to pray about. You know, and we have to get out, and we have to start praying for others. Even if we can't get out, you know, we need to spend time with the Lord and ask him for others, to protect others, you know, to care for others, to protect us, right? There's nothing wrong with asking the Lord to protect us and who we are in Christ, and develop that relationship and keep us stronger. This is the other thing that Jesus says, Revelation 3:20. Go ahead. If you want to turn there. It says, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears my voice and opens the door, I will come into him and dine with him, and he with me." You know, one of the things... I'm sorry, I've had this cough forever. No, I'm okay. We're almost done. One of the things that I truly believe, and I end a lot of my messages with, is, you know, when we give our life to Christ, we're going to have that seat at his table in the kingdom of heaven. Why do we know that? Because if we knock, he's going to invite us in. He's going to call us to a place at his table. And someday we're all going to be there, and someday we're all going to know each other at that place, right? And it's going to be a good time when we get there. But we have to believe. We have to repent, right? The things we have to do to get there is we have to find a way to not only ask the Lord to forgive us for our sins, but us to forgive others when they sin against us. And in today's environment, that's very difficult to do. but we have to do it. We have to do it because we love the Lord. We have to do it because we're obedient to God. There's, you know, no other choice that we have. When we accept the Lord Jesus Christ, we accept Him thick and thin, right? We accept all of Him because why? Because He accepts us. He accepts all of us, right? He doesn't just want part of me. He wants all of me. And when we repent and when we give our lives and we're repentant, then He can work in our lives. And then He can work through our lives. How many of us want God to just work through our lives on a daily basis? You know, to represent, right, who we are in Christ. You know, Paula said it earlier in the songs we were singing. You know, God gave His only Son. His only Son. And you know, the death that Jesus suffered was hard and painful. Yes, He was half human, but He was, you know, God also. But, you know, His human part felt the pain. And we read it in Scripture when He was, you know, sweating. When He was sweating blood. He was in agony. He had a lot of anxiety, so much so that he asked the Lord, you know, take my cup. And what did the Lord say? God said, nothing. But what Jesus said, your will be done. Jesus asked a question and then He answered it right away because he knows what His will was. And, you know, do we know, you know, the things that in our lives, do we know what God's will is for our lives? You know, maybe God put us all here at this place, at this moment, in this time in our country, to band together, right? To pray together. And I think that's, you know, that's important that we understand it. It's important that we continue to stay focused on who Christ is and what is He doing in our lives. You know, we got this word of, you know, about a month ago, Paula got this word, 2 Chronicles 7:14, if you want to turn there. It says, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and heal their land. So many pastors are reading that scripture right now because we all feel the same way. We need the Lord to heal our land. We need repentance. You know, Matthew 3:2-3 says, saying, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. For this is he who was spoken by the prophet Isaiah, saying, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight. What are we talking about? You know, we're talking about God's love. We're talking about repenting. We're talking about preparing the way. In this time, in the time that we're in, you know, when our country is divided, it is so divided that, you know, a lot of people are afraid to go out. A lot of people are afraid to do anything. And it's not just the coronavirus, right? I mean, there's a real fear depending on where you live. You know, if you can go out and enjoy yourself, you know, go have a meal. Try that in LA, you know, it may not bode so well, right? We're kind of fortunate in Orange County here because we're not exposed to a lot of that, but you know, it's happening everywhere. And God is asking us for that repentance. And He's also asking us to prepare the way because He is coming. And He is coming, we don't know His time. And I mentioned this several times, you know, and think about it all the time. God gave us two timelines to live by, right? Do you know what they are? Do you know what the two timelines are? Our end of life timeline and His final judgment timeline, right? So we don't know either timeline. So what should we do? We should be living for Christ. And you should do that now. And we should repent now. And we should start paving the way. And we should start doing what God asks us to do. Because that's what's important. It's not what we want to do anymore, right? We have people who are hurting, right? How can we stand up next to them? You know, we do it with the love of God in us. That's what we have to do, right? That's what we're called to do. Anyway, we don't have to do it, you know, it's our choice. But we're called to do it by the Lord. And if we do that, you know, we're starting. We're starting the revival. We're starting to repent, to show our repentance to the Lord. Because we don't know when His time is. But you know what? I use an analogy. I'll give you this analogy and then we'll wrap up. You know, there have been plenty of awful things happening in our country for many, many years, right? You can go to World War I, World War II, the Korean War, the Vietnam War. Here's a significant difference. In World War I, World War II, this country was still biblically based. There were so many believers who put their trust in God. Right now, it's changed, right? Because we're pushing God out. So that in itself is very, very dangerous. It's a dangerous road to walk on. And we have to be able to lean on the Lord. Because He provides us the love that it takes for us to get through it. He provides us the hope. And He provides the vehicle. And that's through His Word that we can do it. Anyways, let's pray real quick. Dear Father in Heaven, we just thank You, Lord, for this day. We thank You for Your message. Father God, we just ask that You would continue to have grace and mercy on this, this nation and across the globe, Father God. We know that Your time... We know that Your time is short. The other thing is we don't know when Your time is going to come. So. But we know that You're asking all of Your children to start standing in the gap, start repenting, start the revival that You are looking for. Lord, You don't need us, but You want us. You want us to show others the love that You've, you know, poured into us and poured out to others. So these things, we just pray, Father. We just thank You, Lord. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, amen.